We're going to be doing a series on Sunday nights on our favorite psalms. I've had two turned in. I've asked you to do it. But please turn in your favorite psalms. And the night I preach on it, I'm going to have you explain to us why this is your favorite psalms. Two of them that turned it in have talked to me about why that is their favorite psalm. So from now till we start it, and I'll try to get it in the bulletin so we know it, to turn in your favorite psalms, whatever it is, turn it in. And if we have more people in the same psalms, I'll list all three of them, who the favorite psalms is. And I'm going to give them a little time to tell us why. I think it's good to know, okay, that's my favorite verse. And we are going to go through the Bible with our favorite verses. And I'll be preaching on Sunday nights on our favorite verses also. And I'll call it First World Baptist Church of DeSoto's favorite verses. And I think that's good. But I think also whenever I ask someone their favorite verse or whatever, I also always ask them, why is that your favorite verse? Why is that your favorite verse? And they'll tell me, and I really get a blessing because there's some thoughts that come from that that I use in the message because it's just a thought they got that's true to that scripture and it will help all of us be uplifted. Psalm 61, I want you to note this psalm. It is a song of refuge. There are only eight verses. David said, "Hear my cry, O God, listen to my prayer. From the end of the earth I call to you, when my heart is faint," so different than this morning. Verse 2, from the ends of the earth. And verse 3, "For you have been my refuge." Now notice this, "you have been my refuge, a strong tower against the enemy." So this is what God's already done for David. Verse 4, "And let me dwell in the tent forever, in your tent." The wise, he said, there is the tent of God. By the way, in the New Testament, we are the tent of God. We are the tabernacle of God. Jesus Christ dwells in us. The Holy Spirit dwells in us. We are his tabernacle. We're his tent. In the Old Testament, there was a physical tent. There was the tabernacle. There was the temple. And there were tents. And so David was on the run many times, and he slept in a tent. And that tent was anointed by God. And there were times that David was just totally engulfed by God, that he felt there was a tent around him. And he said, "God, please keep me in that tent. Let me take refuge under the shelter of your wings." Wow. "For you, O God, have heard my vows. You have given me the heritage of those who fear your name." This is what I'm going to get, those who fear you. The word fear means trust. The word fear means rely. I feared my dad because my dad had authority. I respected my dad, and I did not want to do anything to hurt my dad. But I also fear God. And the fear of the Lord is your strength because in the fear of the Lord, it draws you to God. It lets you know he is the supreme being. He's the one that can do all things. He's the one that can do anything. And so the fear of the Lord, there is what is called a reverential fear. It is a fear of reverence to God. And that's what he's talking about here tonight. And he said in verse 6, let's do that. "Prolong the life of the king. May his years endure forever before God." Now notice that. Forever, not on this earth, before God in heaven. Look at verse 7. May he be enthroned forever before God. Now, he went on to say, "Appoint steadfast love and faithfulness to the watch over him. So will I ever sing praises to your name as I perform my vows day after day." What he's saying is, every day I want to walk with you, and every day whatever I committed to you, whatever I promised you, I want to fulfill it every day. I want to have a consistent relationship with you, a daily walk with you, and I want it to be open to you, and I want it to be a walk that I know you're there, and I know you know I'm here. Now, different from this morning, we've all been tired, and we've all been run down in life, and there's certain times when it seems like the entire world is against us as we walk the Christian life. We can pray to God. We can know God. We know intimately him. He is our Savior. We've been forgiven of our sins. He's had his Holy Spirit come in us. He's taken away all our sins, buried them as far as the east from the west. He has literally buried them to the place that we can't touch it. He has buried them so deep that you can't reach down and get them. You can talk about them. You can think about them. God will never give them back to you. You can take them back, but God will never give them back to you. Sometimes our friends and our family has left us, and it is in those moments that it seems like all we can do is toss and turn in our beds and never being able to sleep. And each hour is like a whole night. Have you ever had a sleepless night? and you close your eyes, you're praying to go to sleep, and you wake up, it's 2 o'clock. You do everything, you close your eyes, you toss and turn, adjust the covers, adjust the pillow, and you wake up, or so to speak, if you even went to sleep, it's 3 o'clock. And all night seems like that. 1 hour seems like a whole night. And it just seems like 5, 6, 7 days or nights you've been in that bed. And you wake up tireder than you went to sleep. What keeps us awake? When God promises sleep, what is interrupting the promise of God for rest in a life? You ever thought about that? What's interrupted it? It's got to be something. There's got to be something that we're allowing in our lives or in our minds to kind of shadow or put Venetian blinds on our fixed relationship or fixed eyes upon God. If your mind is set on God, I'm telling you, sleep all night. When your mind is on circumstances, problems, illnesses, relationships, it can keep you sleepless. Doesn't mean you're a sinner. It doesn't mean you're a bad person. It doesn't mean that you've done something so terribly wrong. But it does mean right now Satan is having a heyday with your mind. Psalm 61 is a perfect psalm to recite during times. Look at verse 2. Times like that. From the end of the earth will I cry unto thee. When my heart is overwhelmed, lead me to the rock that is higher than I. If I'm going to be fixed, I can't allow anyone where I am fix it. On my level, fix it. It has to be someone higher than me. Someone over me. And so that's what he's talking about in this Psalms. Well, what does it mean to have our hearts overwhelmed? It means our life seems like it's all wrong. In fact, David is recognized as the author of Psalms. And when you read his life, frequently we find himself in situations that the entire world seems to be against him. Even when he is anointed king and God said, you're going to be my king. And God even told him how long he's going to be king, so to speak, that David's throne would never depart from God. And yet you see his kingship many times as a king who runs and even hides in caves. And his own family turns against him. And yet David still had that faith that God was in control. After being plucked from his father's flock, David was constantly sent out to battle. And in fact, he was eventually hunted down by the king Saul because Saul got jealous of him. Saul knew that the favor of God had departed from himself. And he knew that God gave that power, that throne to David. And the rest of Saul's life, he was haunted to the point of madness because of his sin. People who are haunted by God take it out on people. Hear what I said? Do you mind if I take off my jacket? People who are haunted by God or haunted by Satan take it out on people, and generally the people we love the most. Now, I don't have enough wind tonight to really, really come out with this, so let me do it from this perspective, if you will. Please forgive me. No matter the cause or reason, we all can relate with David in this situation. It seems like everything sometimes is against us. Have you ever had, we have a lady in our church right now that's getting ready to have a test, get a diagnosis. Just went through a diagnosis. It was all right. Now she's having another one. One thing on top of another. It's not cancer, but this might be. This is not devastating, but this might be. And so you wait, take the diagnosis, go get the exam, take the various tests that they go through, and the cultures they're going to do, and all that stuff, the biopsies they're going to do, and then you wait, and wait, and wait. And you thank God that that is over with, but now you're facing something brand new before you even get over this. And so let's pray for her. Sometimes we lose our job. Have you ever lost your job, got another job, and it was worse than the job you lost? Yeah. You lose your job. God, give me a job. He gives you one. God, why this one? I thought the other one was bad. That's why I quit. And then I realized, God, you're teaching me something. I don't want to learn. Has God ever taught you something you didn't want to learn? It's a hard lesson to find out. And this is all happening to David at one time. In fact, when you look over your life, and I look over my life, and you think you can stay steady and calm in the storm, and everything's going to be turned around. But under that stress, and under that weight upon your shoulders, instead of getting stronger, you feel or sense like you're getting weaker. But David never lost sight of the one who could deliver him from any of his troubles, and that one's name was the Lord. So let me just ask a few questions, make a few statements, and then I'm going to give you about 8 principles from this passage really quickly. Did you notice that David was a man after God's own heart, struggled with struggles? Now, I mean, humanly speaking, if God calls a man after his own heart, because of his faithfulness, wouldn't you think his life would be a bed of roses? That man, Charlie, is a man after his own heart, God says. So when we hear that Charlie is a man after God's own heart, we want to get close to Charlie. How did Charlie become a man after God's own heart? How did Charlie live his life? What did Charlie do that God had said to him, "You're a man after my own heart"? Surely Charlie would be our example to live our own lives. True? This means yes. This means no. Okay? So we go to Charlie. We say, "Charlie, what are you doing to be a man after God's own heart?" "I'm a man after God's own heart." A man or woman who's truly after God's own heart never shows it, never brags on it. You never hear David ever say, "Hey, I'm a man after God's own heart." Probably because David said, "Well, I'll be telling that. Here I am running. I'm telling it. Look what's happening in my family. Look what's happening in my kingdom. Look what's happening to me. How could I be a man's after God's own heart when everything is going wrong in my life?" You can be right with God, but you're going to be wrong with the world. And if you're right with God and wrong with the world, you're going to suffer tribulations and temptations. In fact, David's life was filled, like many of our lives, with hardship, heartaches, and hurts, and all kinds of heartbreaks. Did you notice that David's thinking about life and service during this time? Can't you imagine David say, "Well, if this is all I get, being faithful to God, I might as well give up." But you don't hear him say that. Did you notice God's great love for the King David in this passage and other passages? It was God's unchanging love that David, no matter what came his way, God loved him, and God's love was always available to him, and God's love was unconditional. God loves us reminds me of a chorus we used to sing when I was a teenager. You may remember it. I love you because you first loved me and purchased my salvation on Calvary. But it is not, I love you because you've been so good to me and shelter my life from enemies. That's not the song. The song is, you love me, but in order to love me, you had to be crucified. You had to die. In order to love me, you had to give your son's life to love me. How can we say we love God if we've given nothing of valuable back to God? How can we say we love God and we're not willing to sacrifice? We're not willing to be committed. We're not willing to be true to God. The evidence of my love for anyone is what I'm doing with them, for them, and to them. Did you notice that the faithfulness and spiritual strength of David was real? But do you see his inner feelings being revealed? Even though David was strong, and even though he is faithful, even though he's trusting God, he said at this time, the situations of this world, even though I am right with God, even though I am God's man after his own heart, even though I'm the king that he appointed, even though I'm a man of God, I trust him, I serve him, I sing to him, even though all those things, I'm overwhelmed by circumstances. Circumstances overwhelm many of us at times, all the time, sometimes. And we tend to blame ourselves for our weak moments during burdensome times. Let me make a statement. Most Christians are harder on themselves than God is on them. Most Christians cannot forgive themselves as fast as God forgives them. And most Christians can't forget their sins like God has forgiven and forgotten. Most of us have the wrong look. Even after we're saved, we still have the look of what we did, and we really don't really dwell on what God is doing in our lives and going to do. And Satan's very good through people. "Oh, Tim, I remember we used to drink together." And I'm just giving you illustrations. Oh, Tim, we used to drink together. Or my wife, we used to smoke weed together. Did she give you any, Chris? Where's Chris? She doesn't give you any. Bless your heart. She's selfish. Her idea now is to sell it and give 10% to the church. Now, we're joking about that. Just understand that. We got to understand it. We got to always remember something, folks, and that is we are unique. We're made by God. We're created by God, and God created a special human being. You are special. You are unique, and in God's sight, you are His precious child. You may be going through it, but He's with you in it. He understands more about you than anybody else. Even when we all get overwhelmed, remember, God made each of us with a purpose. You know, if you never got overwhelmed, we would try to do everything in our own strength. Do you understand? If you've never felt overwhelmed, we would do everything in our own strength. Because if you've never felt overwhelmed, why would you need God? I got this. I can do this. I can call so-and-so and they'll give me money for it. I can do this and I'll get this and I'll get this and I'll get this. So I can do it with all my problems by myself. Ladies and gentlemen, there are going to be problems that will come your way that you will not be able to handle by yourself. And God is letting you know that you're human. And God is letting you know you need His strength. And God is letting you know you need Him. Why would we pray to God if we think we can do it? Many times we don't pray as often as we need to pray because we think we got it. I mean, why would I pray, God, help me buy groceries when I can buy them out of my checking account? Why would I ask God, Lord, help me buy a car when I can buy it on my savings account or make payments? Why would I say, God, help me with this when I can get it myself? I can do it myself. So many times what we think we're doing without understanding that God is helping us do it, even though we didn't pray for it, He is providing all our needs. So many times the last thing we do is pray, and we only pray when we're overwhelmed. When we can't do it. When life has thrown us a curveball and now we're stopped in our tracks, and that's when we cry out. You understand the word to be overwhelmed means to be buried or drowned or beneath a huge mass. Did you know there's people in the Bible, great men and women of the Bible that were overwhelmed? Jesus Christ was overwhelmed in His humanity. In Mark 14, 32 to 35, it said they came to a place that was named Golgotha or Gethsemane. You know what He did? And I'm just going to paraphrase it. They came to that place. He asked the disciples to pray. He went away and prayed. Came back. They were asleep. He asked them to pray again. And He prayed so hard, so overwhelmed, that his sweat was like drops of blood. He was in agony. He was crying out to the Father. He was totally overwhelmed to the place He said, God, really, I don't want to do this, but not my will, thine be done. I will go through it because You have sent me here. And in obedience to what You want me to do, I will do. But He was overwhelmed. Peter was overwhelmed in his sin. You remember in Mark 26, verse 75. After that cock crowed, and after he had denied the Lord three times, and after he was standing, remember when they were taking Jesus out, Jesus looked at Peter, and their eyes met, and Peter broke. He was overwhelmed with his sin of denial or disobeying God. He came to the point, no doubt at that point, that he almost thought about Judah when he thought, well, what Judas did to fix his overwhelming heart, he went out and hung himself. I do believe there was a time in Peter's life that he said, what's the use? God doesn't need me. But you remember after the resurrection, Jesus said, go get, and Peter, Jesus called out the very one that betrayed him. He called him out individually by name to let him know, I don't care what you do to me. You can't do anything to stop my love. And I'm not calling you back. I'm not changing your commission. I'm not changing your appointment as a disciple. Yes, you've been overwhelmed. But Peter got overwhelmed because he tried to do it himself. I'll never deny you. Folks, I always tell parents, don't ever say your children not do this. And don't ever say that you won't do something. You'll eat those words. We're not strong enough to say never. Jesus knew how he felt. And Jesus knows how we feel when we're overwhelmed. In fact, God knows we do not know all things. We're human, and we have no idea what's going to happen tomorrow. We can guess, but we don't know. We can go to work this morning. On the way to work, a car could hit us and wipe us out of this world. We never dreamed that. Chris, when he was here, never dreamed that 2 days after he's in this church, sitting in this church, listening to the message here, and our prayers and our songs, never even thought, nor did his sister Samantha, ever thought 2 days he's gone. Never. God knows we're not everywhere at the same time. We can't be. We're earthly vessels. So I got a good news. Although we can't be, God is. So therefore, wherever we go, he's already there. He's in the future. He's in the present. He's in the past. He's above us. He's below us. There is no way you can run from him. There's no way you can get away from him. And even though your heart may seem overwhelmed, God is right there to help you. God knows when we're but human, but we also are not superhuman. Have you known someone who thinks they're superhuman and they do all things? Never get the proper sleep, never get the proper rest. They just keep going and going and going, and they just go and go and go. And sometimes people think if they don't do it, God will never do it. And if God, listen, if they're taken out of the picture, the project will never get done. It won't be very long when you die or I die that the world will forget me and life will go on, this church will go on, and everything will go on just as if I never existed. We're but a drop in a bucket. You put a pedal, drop it in the ocean, how long do you see it? The results. Not long. And that's how long our influence many times in life is once we leave this world. So God has to be there. We also need to remind ourselves of what Paul said. When we come to the end of our strength, it's then we find his. It is at the end of our power that we find here. 2 Corinthians chapter 12, Paul said this, verse 9 and 10. And he said unto me, my grace is sufficient for thee, for my strength is made perfect in weakness. Most gladly, therefore, I'd rather glory in my infirmities that the power of God may rest upon me. He said, you know, it's in your weakness, Paul. Paul said, well, then I'm going to glorify in him. I want you to get the credit. If I'm going to be strong in my weakness, I want to be weak. He goes on to say, therefore, I take pleasure in infirmities and reproaches and necessities and persecution and distresses for Christ's sake. For when I am weak, then I'm strong. How could that be? Because it's in those weak moments that we realize we can't do it. We're not strong enough. We're not powerful enough. And we realize we need God. And it's in the weakest moments of our life we become strongest for God because we rely on him more than any other time. Remember when we're afraid of worry or we can about trust and relying on God. We sometimes worry about those things. But let me tell you something. God will always provide and God will always protect. Psalms 56:3. What time I'm afraid or when I was afraid, I will trust in thee. It's amazing to me every time I get worried, every time I get fearful, God reminds me of himself. He knocks on the door of my heart and the door of my spirit. And from this chapter, I see about 8 things that kind of glean some lessons from these chapters, this chapter, and I'm going to go through them very quickly. And all God's people said, amen. Thank you, Ed. Lesson number 1, found in verse 1, is the closeness of God. That the Lord is just a prayer away. Notice he said, I cry unto the Lord. And God is right there. Hear my cry, O God. Attend unto my prayer. Hear, attend. And so what we have to understand, when we go through these things, when we're overwhelmed, understand this principle, this thought, whatever you want to call it, precept. When I feel like that, it may be the first time and the best time I sense the closeness of God, because when you pray, the closest you'll ever be to God, because you're talking to him, you're asking him. Number two. You see the watch care of God, if you'll see in verse 2. No matter how low we get, God is always higher to lead us up and not down. From the end of the earth I will cry unto thee, he says, and when my heart is overwhelmed, lead me to the rock that is higher than I. So notice, God is up here. God is always watching. His watch care is always there. And so when we come to this place, we understand that God is always watching over me. And that's good to know. When I was a child and I was afraid of the dark, thanks to my brothers. I don't know if you had brothers like mine. They were mean. I was never mean to any of them, but they were mean to me. And they'd always try to scare me at night. Because, look, there's somebody looking through the window. And then they'd make me sleep on the side of the bed where the window was. We're not going to lock the doors tonight. I hear something out there. You hear that walking? Somebody's coming through the cornfield. You know? By the time they got through talking, I was crying. And they said, you call out to Dad and we'll beat the living daylights out of you. You know, it's wonderful to know that God is always leading us on higher trails. He's always up there. His path leads to his power. His path leads to his strength. His path leads to his peace. David said, God is a gigantic boulder compared to all these little pebbles that I'm going through. Number three. Notice the protection of God in verse 3. God is our shelter and our high tower. Now, in those days, a high tower was a place where it was built to where all people could run to it for protection and safety. And God is the one we run to for protection and high and safety. He said, for thou art my shelter for me and a strong tower from my enemies. So he shelters me and he keeps my enemies away. He protects me, provides for me, and he overpowers the enemies when we cry out to him. I love Proverbs 18, 1 and 2. The name of the Lord Yahweh is a strong tower. The righteous run into him and is safe. God is ever protecting us from the enemies from without and the enemies from within. The strong tower is a metaphor. It emphasizes the protection of Yahweh. Now, Yahweh is the name for God. You know this. You've studied Old Testament. And what follows after Yahweh really is the highlights of his attributes. So it says like this. It says Yahweh Jireh, which literally means God is my provider. Yahweh Rapha, which literally means the God who heals. It talks about Yahweh Nisi, which is the God who is my banner. Yahweh Shalom, which God is my peace. So every time he mentions Yahweh, he gives an attribute of Yahweh. So this is Yahweh. I cry to Yahweh. When I need peace, I cry to Yahweh Shalom, who is the God who gives me peace. And whatever I need, when I find the name of God and the character or attributes of God, and I'm going through that particular problem, that's the God attribute I cry for and cry to help me through that particular problem that I have. Well, number four, the promise of God. Faithful to God's house keeps us in a safe place. And look at verse 4. I will abide in thy tabernacle forever. Stop, period, question mark, whatever. This is a statement that I wish God's people today would learn. To be faithful to the house of God. Because every time you miss and someone comes, it says, so this is all the people you have here? How many members do you have? I've had this question. How many members do you have? And I'll tell them about. And this is all you have? Where are your members? It is easier to stay out of church than be faithful to church. It's easier to do things on Wednesday night, Sunday morning, Sunday afternoon, Sunday night than it is any other day of the week. And as time progresses, I've noticed it as a pastor, things unheard of missing church are on a regular basis now. And he said, look, I will abide in thy tabernacle forever. I will trust in the shelter of the wings of God. The word abide there means I will dwell, I'll stay, I'll be there. It is interesting. The word says, I will trust in, or I will trust unto the secrets of his wings is what he's saying. And this, he determines to make his refuge in the presence while he's in the world under the almighty wings of God. Wow. Let's go to number five, the gift of temporal and eternal life. Be committed to your commitments to God. Look at verse 5. For thou, O God, hast heard my vows, my commitments. Thou hast given me a heritage of those that fear thy name. So I'm in the crowd that fear you. I'm in the crowd that's committed to you. Remember to keep your vows you made to God. How many of us, when we got saved, promised God something? You ever heard of foxhole conversions? You people in the service know those. That's when men or women in a foxhole and the enemy is approaching them and they're being shot at, they'll cry out to God and make a vow. God, if you'll get me out of here, I'll serve you the rest of my life. I'll preach for you. I'll do whatever you want me to do. As soon as they get home from the service or the war, they never enter the house of God. I put very little stock in foxhole conversions. Some have been true. But many times, what generally makes us or come to God in those situations, it is so easy to have another situation take us away from God. Number 6, there is the principle, the precept of the sustaining of God. Notice what he says in verse 6. God's promise to give David a long and fruitful life. Thou wilt prolong the king's life, and his years are many generations. I will make this statement about that. The shortest day of a child of God's life is longer than the longest day of a sinner's life. The shortest day is longer than the longer day of an unbeliever's life. You ever sung the song, "Every Day with Jesus, Sweeter as the Days Go By"? Every day with Jesus, I love him more and more. Jesus saves me and keeps me. And he's the one I'm waiting for. Every day with Jesus is sweeter than the day before. We can sing that song. We can sing it with joy, and we can sing it with anticipation or excitement. But my problem is, or my thoughts is, Tim, when you sing that song, is it true? I think we sing a lot of hymns and a lot of songs in church. We say the words, but we don't really mean those words. Number 7, the inviting presence of God and the prepared mercy and prepared truth he gives. Verse 7, he shall abide before God forever. Now notice this, oh, prepare mercy. Anybody know what mercy is? Mercy. What does it mean? What's mercy? God is withholding from us what we deserve. Grace is God is giving to us what we don't deserve. And here he's saying God is preparing to stop something that I deserve, that I would never want. And God is preparing to give me something I don't deserve, that when I give it, when I get it, it's unbelievable. In your life and in my life, God is always preparing, getting ready to give us, withdraw those things, mercy, giving us, taking away those things we ought to deserve, and putting in our lives those wonderful blessings that he has for us. Boy, that's a great God, isn't it? That's a great God to know he does that. Well, I know I've got to hurry. Everybody's just looking at me. Some are half asleep, so I'll hurry. Number 8, the continual worship from man, the promise of continuous. Look at verse 8, continuous worship. So I will sing praises unto thy God forever, that I may daily perform my vows. He praises the Lord for his benefits. He praises the Lord for the hope that God has given him. He praises the Lord as perpetual praise, which is continuous praising. The hardest time to praise God is sometimes the best time to praise God. It's hard to praise God when everything's going wrong, but that's the greatest time and best time to praise him. Because when I start praising God, when I'm going through a situation, trouble, a trial, or whatever, I find out immediately that my thoughts and my moods and my heart is lifted up to the one I'm looking at, the one I'm praising. And the things of this world are starting to grow strangely dim out of my praise. God loves praise. Be honest with you, you do too. Every one of us like a pat on the back instead of a kick in the rear. I mean, I always do that. I mean, we love praise. You know, don't come in here and say, I never want people to brag on me. Don't tell me that. We're created in our natural instinct for us to want praise. We want to be thankful. We want people to be thankful. You know, be honest, we all do. We want people to say thank you once in a while. We want people to say, boy, you did a good job. Children do, amen? And they need it. There are some children that we have dealt, Pam and I have dealt with in Sunday school, church, and school, and I'm sure some of you school teachers have dealt with it. Some of the kids have never had praise from their parents. Never. They've never heard the name of God unless it's in vain. Jesus is a cuss word. That's all they've heard. They've never been told that that someone loves them without wanting something. They've never been told that they're precious. They've never been told, I love you. You're so sweet. You're wonderful. Thank you, man. That's a great job. They've never been told that. If they come home with an A, the parents will say, why didn't you get an A+? I'm in it. They get an A+. How come you didn't get a note from the teacher or the principal saying how great a student you were? How come you didn't get student of the year? I'm not lying to you. There are parents that are rough on children to the point, no matter what that child does, they're going to criticize. You're setting up a child for failure. Aren't you glad that God doesn't criticize us? In fact, when you look at the totality of this Psalms, it is a Psalms that really indicates a fervent desire to worship God. David is overwhelmed by God. He has a desire to be with him, and he wants to enjoy God's presence, and he has confident hope that God will be there for him. And what does David do? He gives God the glory. And we ought to do. Yes, we're going to be overwhelmed. And yes, we're going to have difficulty. Yes, we're going to have problems. But I'm telling you what, there's nothing this earth can throw at us that God can't kick it right back. He's a gracious God. God be with us tonight, we pray. As well as we get overwhelmed with things, would you overwhelm us with your presence? And we'll thank you for it in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you. Love you. Have a great week. And there is no Sunday school teachers and officers meeting today.